They're very encouraging. They bring hope. Appreciate the message of the prophet, the apostle. Something we need. And I do see tremendous protection going through life when you have an open ear for that prophet, when you have an open ear for that apostle. You can actually be prepared before things ever come, because they have a tendency to pick up on things beforehand. And some of the things they pick up on is pretty astounding. You know, I read, sometimes I go through the minor prophets like Joel and Haggai, and there's some other ones in there. But some of those men, they seen something that nobody else seen. And they seen it coming. And I want to read a little bit out of Joel here a little later on here this evening. I'm going to ask Brother Manny, if you don't mind coming up here and opening us up with a word of prayer, please.
All right.
Thank you.
Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to hear your word. I pray over our hearts, that our hearts will be open to receive your word, to receive your doctrines. There's things that are hidden, there's mysteries hidden in the word that we need revealed to us. And right now I pray for the spirit of revelation to come in tonight and help to understand the word, to reveal the word, and to bring things to light that need to be brought to light tonight, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, brother. Amen. You know, there's a phrase, the psalmist had a phrase in Psalms. And I think we kind of changed that phrase in the times we're living in. And that phrase goes somewhere along the lines, it doesn't say this exactly, but I was glad when they said, let us go to the Super Bowl. Or I was glad when they said, we're going to watch Harry Potter tonight. You know, the psalmist had a hold of something. He had something inside of him. There was something inside of his being. And he was glad when they said, let us go into the house of the Lord tonight. And I want to stir that gladness up inside of you. You know, as you go through a Christian walk, sometimes there's obstacles you hit. Sometimes there's trials or tests that come your way. And I believe for you and I as Christians, it's a good idea to have that gladness inside of us. Let us go to the house of the Lord. And something I'm finding out, if that gladness is not inside of you, you can get it inside of you. But I believe one of the reasons it'll leave, one thing that'll cause that gladness to leave a person is when that mind starts going after carnality. It starts going after the things of the world. Automatically, that joy, that zeal, that gladness inside of you. You know, the Super Bowl, I look at it as, it's a worldly thing. If you want to watch it, or, you know, I'm not going to condemn you if you watch the Super Bowl. I haven't watched it in a while, but not condemning you. But I do know if you wholeheartedly indulge after the things of the world, eventually it'll start affecting you. Amen. It'll eventually start affecting your spirit life. And the psalmist knew that. So I want to talk about some things in the mind. And if you can, I'm going to ask you to turn to Revelations. We're going to go to Revelations chapter 21. Verse 27. Revelations 21, verse 27. And I want to bring this out as a mind thing. You know, it's important for you and I to protect our mind. It's important that we have the right kind of thought patterns. And here it talks about a pretty, talking about heaven here. And there shall in no wise enter in it anything that defileth, neither whatsoever a worketh abomination, or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. And I want to take that verse to your mind tonight. If we can come to a place here in life where anything that causes defilement, anything that causes an abomination against God, we don't allow that thing in here. You know, let me just use this thing right here as somewhat an illustration. The Lord was dealing with me on this a little while back. You and I, we go through life, and I believe we got a pretty clear understanding of what the right is, what the wrong is. And I'm kind of talking more in your mind tonight. Your heart, your mind. You might not share this stuff with people. But, you know, how comfortable, that thing that is an abomination, how comfortable are you being around that thing? Having that thing right beside you. And, you know, I believe it's a good idea for us to recognize that thing as an enemy and cut it off our lives. Get it away from it. You and I step away from it. You know, another thing, another picture I had seen a while back was, and again, this goes back to our minds. We have these little petty things. People, they got these little petty ideas. It could be an idea, it could be lust, it could be arrogancy, it could be pride, it can be self-esteem, whatever it might be. In our minds. And you know, I see it as a stone that comes in the way. Another thing you can look at it is, it can be a pet. A fox. The Bible talks about the little foxes, they spoil the vine. You know, I was driving down the road a while back here. And I was going back a country road on my way to work. And here was a little fox. He just got hit on the road. Cutest little thing. Beautiful, I mean, just cute. He was just freshly killed. But you know, that little fox in your mind, it can mess you up. And the best thing you can do is chase that thing out of your life. Maybe you need to shoot it. But, you know, that's my pet. When I'm all by myself, when I'm lonely, I just kind of like to step down in that pit and think about these things. But you know, that hurts us. That little fox, if that thing plays around in your mind enough, that seed of God or that sprouting of the Lord coming up inside of you, it'll trample that thing underfoot. And that's what I see about the thing. You know, how comfortable are you around that? You know it's wrong, but yet, every so often you kind of, you know, you go beside that thing time and time again. And I want to encourage you and I, as believers, to cut that thing out of our lives. Because that thing does not have the security, the strength, the courage that we need to be victorious. It'll always, on the long run, it'll hurt you. And I want to go to the book of Job here. The first chapter. Job, this man being a man of God. He lived an amazing life. Had a hold of some things. And this man had the fear of God in his life. Everything all right over there? But anyway, this man, he had the fear of God in his life. And you know, if you and I can get the fear of God in our lives to the extent that this man had, I believe we're going to go somewhere. He cared about His children. Starting in verse 1. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was perfect and upright and one that feared God and eschewed evil. And there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters. His substance also was 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 she-asses, and a very great household, so that this man was the greatest of all the men of the East. And his sons went and feasted in their houses, every one his day, and sent and called their 3 sisters to eat and to drink with them. And it was so, when the days of feasting were gone about, that Job sent and sanctified them, and rose up early in the morning, and offered burnt offerings. Now this guy, he had some integrity inside of him. This is something that he did on behalf of his children. I believe there was protection in this man's house. And offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. And Job said, "It may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts." Thus did Job continually. And you know, a lifestyle this man had was those burnt offerings. One was set up for each one of his children. And he did this on a daily basis. As a protection. I believe it was as a protection to his family, as a protection to his home. And you know, I found that very powerful. You and I, having that urgency inside of us for the seed that is a part of us. This man had a hold of something. And you know, you as a man, you as a wife, you as a youth, whether you're a lady, whether you're a man, there's seed inside each one of us. It's this Word of God. And you know, planting that seed, I see it important to plant that seed, to have the ground fertile, to handle that seed correctly when you're around people. Try and put it into people. You know, if you get corn, if you get some corn seeds and you sprinkle them out here in this driveway, they're probably not going to come up. If they do come up, this summer when the hot sun comes out, they're not going to keep growing. But to know that fertile soil, and even in our own hearts, you know, you might have a stone of whatever it might be. Remove it. You know, another thing in people's minds today that you see a lot is just heard of a preacher here recently, and a guy met him at a restaurant somewhere, and this is a man, he had a hold of something. At one time in his life, he had a hold of something. He was able to stand behind a pulpit and preach a message. And it brought conviction to people. But anyway, he was in this restaurant and couldn't figure out who this one guy was. And you know, the day his sayings is, "Well, I got to go get him. Let me go back to the counter here. I got to get another beer here. I got to figure out who you are. I just can't figure out who you are." You know, somewhere there's a generation that's lost out. And I want to encourage you and I tell you, some of these people, I believe they need somebody to help restore them.
That's right.
And somehow, you and I, if we can somehow get in there and help restore some of these men, some of these women, it's what this society needs. Somebody that's going to show mercy. Somebody that's going to show loving kindness. And you know, in Proverbs, it talks about who hath woe? Who hath sorrows? Who hath contentions? Who hath wounds without cause? Who hath redness of eyes? And these are problems. And if you keep reading in that verse, it talks about they that tarry long at the wine. They that seek after mixed drink or mixed wine, something along that lines it says. And you know, there's some other things that follow that line. It says, they shall, their eyes shall behold strange women. Their heart, it shall, it's not a maybe. That word shall is there. It shall utter perverse things. And it goes on and says, I'm going to turn there. I'm going to read a couple of verses there in the latter part of Proverbs 23:29. You know, we were trying to get some of this stuff across to the prisoners, and they seemed to latch hold of it. Proverbs 23, go to the latter part of it. At last, let's go to 23, verse 32. At last it biteth like a serpent and stingeth like an adder. Thine eyes shall behold strange women, thy heart shall utter perverse things. Yea, thou shalt be as he that lieth down in the midst of the sea, or as he that lieth on top of the mast. And you know, something that is, if I see instability, it would be in a man that is lying out in the midst of the sea. Or a man that is on the top of a mast. If I understand the top of a mast right, it has something to do with a sail that you put on a sailboat. And lying on top of that thing, you can about mark it down, destruction's going to come. It's not going to work. And if you're lying in the middle of the sea, but you know, the reason I'm bringing this out is there's a lot of people I'm around from time to time up in Pennsylvania. And, you know, it doesn't matter. When I have a few drinks, it doesn't matter. And been challenged to handle these conversations correctly. Whether you're a preacher, whether you're not a preacher, their intake on it is, you know, God doesn't really care. If you just have a few drinks here and there, but I tell you, if you go to the Word of God, it's a big deal.
Right.
Your protection is taken away from you. And you know, another thing in the mind that I've been challenged on in the mind is that mind of yours, is it geared toward being a pessimist, or is that mind geared toward being an optimist? And there's a drastic difference between the two. And you know, if we can get a group of people together and we can get their minds in an optimist mindset. I tell you, I believe you can get a group of people together and they can become optimists. They know that they can accomplish certain things. They're going to go somewhere. That group of people is unstoppable. And recently I've been thinking, you know, some of this stuff I believe we need in our lives, even as a church. Because this Bible, there's a couple Bible verses I meditate on from time to time. I've found out if I'm going through a battle or I feel like I need to get myself pepped up, I keep bringing them up. And one is, behold, I've given you power to tread over serpents, over scorpions, over all the powers of the enemy. Nothing shall by any means hurt thee. Another one is, to them that believe, they shall lay hands on the sick. They shall recover. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. There's word shall is in there. That means it will happen. It's a guaranteed fact. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall speak with new tongues. And another one is, if any two of you shall agree as touching anything, it shall be done of my Father which is in heaven. You know, some of these things, you start meditating in your mind, grasping hold of it, meditating these things in your mind. Some of those little foxes, these little pets that we have going on inside of you, they don't have room. Recently we got together as a family and we decided, you know, we're going to get together around the table and we're going to make a prayer list. And we're going to lay our hands on that prayer list as a family. And it's amazing what the Lord will do if you get a husband and a wife in unity. If you get the children in unity and you get a prayer list and lay your hands on that prayer list. You know, it wasn't a very long period of time. We started crossing some of those things off. This one got crossed off. A little later, this one here got crossed off. And you know, whatever it might be, you need more of love. Or maybe you got debt. Or maybe there's some other needs that you have in your life. The Bible says, if any two of you shall agree as touching anything, it shall be done of my Father which is in heaven. You know, my wife and I, we had prayed one night. We had a lot of medical expense last year. Had some things kind of went sour on us. One of our employees, he went and put his finger into a table saw, cut one of his fingers off, messed a couple others up that he's still has issues with them. And then later on, I had an accident where I had fell, and anyway, we added up quite a bit of medical expense. And we made an agreement to pray against that thing that at the end of the year we can have this paid in full. Jesus. And on the last day of the year, I was able to get that credit card out and pay that thing in full. I could just so do it. And, you know, agreement, the power of agreement, it is powerful. And the other thing was, so we decided this year, okay, we're going to pray that we don't have any medical expenses this year. The Lord would spare us. We don't need to go down that road. 2 days later, one of the guys I was working with, he was nailing up a couple boards across a stairway. He was getting ready to close it up, just like it's a safety thing. Well, something happened to the compressor. The thing all of a sudden shut off. And he put one nail on this board. So we had to go down and get the thing started up again. And he went to put some more boards across his stairway so he can lay some plywood across it, not knowing that he only had one nail in that one board. And don't you think he went and stepped on that thing? And down he went into the next floor. And that board, he stepped on it, stayed with him. It hit another piece of wood partway up in the air and got him right here in the shoulder, snapped the board in half. The 2x4 completely got snapped in half. And from there, he went and fell down on his side. It was about 10 feet, something like that. And he stands right back up and comes right up to the second floor. And a little later on, I happened to realize, you know, my wife and I had just prayed about that. It was two nights or so before that. And you know the power of prayer, God's protection on our lives. If we can be in agreement, if you can get two people in agreement, and I find it very powerful, I tell you, if a husband and a wife are in agreement, their prayers won't be hindered. And you can go somewhere. I'm going to turn to Ephesians chapter 6, and it talks about the mind, talks about the helmet of salvation. I'm going to read a few verses out of there, starting in verse 12. For we wrestle not with flesh and blood. Now hold on here. I'm reading in the Amplified. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand, therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that wherein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. Going down over this verse, I went down over this verse recently, and sometimes in life, I believe you need to take off that breastplate of righteousness and put that thing back on you again. Make it fit. Maybe you need to get a new one. And the same way with the helmet of salvation. I believe it's a good idea sometimes to take that helmet off and tuck that thing back on your head. Get yourself ready. Prepare yourself for battle. You know, you and I, we are in a daily battle. And I believe if we can win this battle in our minds, we're going to be victorious. You know, I had a guy in detention center a little while back, and these guys, they always have a tendency to try to mess with a preacher's mind. And so I kind of enjoy it for some reason. They're young guys, and I enjoy going in there and ministering to them. They're very energetic, very young. It's a generation. Most of them, if you ask them, do you have a Bible? Two of them might raise their hands. Did you ever have somebody teach you out of the Bible? Was the Word of God ever taught to you? And sometimes you won't get any response out of them. So they don't know anything about David. They don't know anything about the stories in the Bible. But anyway, recently I was in there preaching, and this one guy, he really got irritated at what I was saying. And he couldn't handle it any longer. So he decided, well, he's going to shut me down. He just right away started butting out and pointed at me. He said, "Preacher, this Jesus that you're talking to me about, it doesn't work. It's not real." And he said, "If Jesus was real, I wouldn't be in here." I said, "Okay, well, just then, this Islam guy." He said, "All right." He said, "Now it's my turn. I want to talk to you about some things too." So this time I decided, you know, I'm going to get a little bit more bold and arrogant with these guys. Show some love. Show some joy. They don't know what to do with joy and respect and rejoicing when this stuff goes on. So this Islam guy, he raises his hand. He's getting about ready to unload on me, sitting right up on front. Like, he's going to tell me what to do. I said, "All right, I'm going to go right over to him and just, if he wants to rebuke me, he's going to rebuke me face to face." And he started going off to me, and then he's like, "You know what? I lost my train of thought. I can't remember what I was going to tell you anymore." But you know, something I've found with this young generation, when you show love, when you show respect, when you show honor, it's something they haven't seen. And even though they might rebuke you, even though they might come against you, I've found out that is something that always wins in the end. Most of the time, those guys will ask for prayer. You know, that Islam guy, he wanted prayer before I left them doors that night. There was about four or five of them wanted prayer. He said, "You can't touch me. I'm not going to let you touch me, but I will ask you to pray. I have a few situations I need help in my life." I want to turn to Joel here. I got some more scriptures I want to read. Joel chapter 2, or Joel chapter 3. And this is talking about a generation. I believe they were busy. I believe they were living in wickedness. They had addictions in their lives. And the prophet had picked up on it. He had seen it and started warning them. We'll start in chapter 3, verse 1. "For behold, in those days and in that time, when I shall bring again the captivity of Judea and Jerusalem, I will also gather all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat and will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and part of my land." You know, verse 3, I had to think, seems a lot like the times we're living in today. A lot of people have addictions, and they're not willing to let go of them. Doesn't matter what the cost is, that addiction or that thing that is in their mind, they're not willing to let go of that thing. Because here it says, "And they have cast lots for my people, and have given a boy for a harlot, and sold a girl for wine that they might drink. Yea, and what have ye to do with me, O Tyria and Zidon, and all the coasts of Palestine? Will ye render me a recompense? And if ye recompense me swiftly and speedily, I will return your recompense upon your own head. Because ye have taken my silver and my gold, and have carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things. The children also of Judea and the children of Jerusalem have ye sold unto the Grecians, that ye might move them far from the border. Behold, I will raise them out of the place whither they have sold them, and will return your recompense upon your own heads. And I will sell your daughters, your sons and your daughters, into the hand of the children of Judea, and they shall sell them to the Sabaeans, to a people afar off." You know, this prophet, he's seen a problem in this valley. And I believe these men, they were busy. And I would say it was the springtime of the year again. Because it talks about plowing, talks about pruning if you go on down here. Verse 9, "Proclaim ye this among the Gentiles, prepare war, wake up the mighty men, let all the men of war draw near. Let them come up. Beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I am strong." And you know what I get out of verse 10? This prophet, he had an urgency inside of him. And he was telling these people, that plow, get off that plow. Get that plow and beat it into a sword. That pruning hook that you're using to trim that tree, beat that thing into a spear. And there was urgency in this. I don't think that they had the time. There was a war was coming, and I don't believe they had the time to go back into their house to get a spear, to get a whatever it might have been, a weapon of war. And another thing he brought out is, wake up the mighty men. Those that are weak, let them rise up. Let the weak say that I'm strong. And you know, this is talking about a God of the living. And something I see time and time again in this word is, because you're outnumbered doesn't mean that you're not able to have the victory in your life.
That's right.
You know, Gideon, he was able to do it with an army of 300. Daniel, somehow he was able to sustain himself in a strange land. Joseph was another one. He was a man, somehow he had the goods inside of him to sustain himself in a strange land. And I believe these men, they girded up the loins of their mind. Somehow they got a hold of God. Somehow they were able to get through those times victoriously. Verse 11, "Assemble yourselves and come, all ye heathen, and gather yourselves together round about. Hither cause thy mighty ones to come down, O Lord. Let the heathen be wakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there will I sit to judge all the heathen round about." Verse 13, "Put ye in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, get you down, for the press is full and the vats overflow, for the wickedness is great." And you know, I believe that's it's a sign of judgment coming. But if you and I can see the urgency inside of this scripture, I want to bring this into our minds. I believe there's an urgency for each one of us to take care of our minds. That little thing that we might think it's a pet, I believe it's a good idea to get rid of it, to shoot it or to chase it away. And you know, I find this, if we can control our minds, we can be a people that can go somewhere together. We can be victorious together. And there's a world out there that's waiting. Another thing I've seen important recently is the power of communication. I usually find out if I got the right kind of communication going between me and my wife, things just flow so much easier. And something I find out, if that communication is not there between my wife and I, it can be a signal that something might be off a little bit somewhere. And very powerful. Find it the same way, you know, out in the workplace. If you can keep that communication going with those that you're around, it just seems like when something difficult comes up, when something hard comes up, if you got that communication in the right place, you're able to go right through that thing. You know, something I found out is if when you go through a hard time without communication, a husband and a wife, you can start to think weird things about each other. Or you can start to kind of think something that your spouse wasn't even intending. Powerful communication. And I also see it powerful with our children. Communication with our children, it makes life easier. You know, I see some of these men give their hearts to the Lord. That's amazing what it does when a man gives his heart to the Lord. Usually sometime later in his life, that man inside of him, he starts being drawn back into his family. He used to hate his wife, or he used to hate his children. Now he wants to go make things right with his family and get back together with them. And you know, that power of communication. We had a man a little while back, he wanted to get back in touch with his daughter. And he wasn't able to because his daughter didn't want anything to do with him. But you know, our thing was keep praying for her. Keep bringing her before the Lord. And you know, eventually that man was able to talk to her again. And another thing is, this is another one that's in our minds, is a grudge. Grudges. There's something the enemy wants to do. If he can somehow put a wedge between two sisters, or if he can put a wedge between two brothers, usually it'll start a lot of times with a small grudge. And I've found out, being in leadership in Pennsylvania, I've found out as soon as I see that thing at all in our leadership, to go after it. Because I found out a little while back, the number one agenda for the enemy would be to try to get a grudge between me and my pastor. Try to get a grudge between me and one of the leaders.
Yeah.
And I found out the best way to counteract that thing is just go up to the brother and bless you. Spend time with him. Talk to him. It clears it up. You know? I believe a lot of these things are put in front of us to see what you and I are made of. And the sooner you take care of that thing, the less power and the less effect it's going to have in trying to wear you out or to bring you down. So, if you got a grudge with somebody, I believe one of the best things you can do is go bless that person. Go talk with that person. That weakens the enemy from trying to have his way in that situation. Another thing is, you know, your tone of voice, joy, peace, love. You know, you and I as a people of God, if we can keep peace, if we can keep rejoicing, joy, these things are very vital in our walk. If we keep those things on the forefront of our lives, I believe things can happen around us and they don't affect us. We won't be affected by them. We'll be able to be victorious over them. You know, I was in a prison here recently, and had a group of there was a group of about 50 men. They were all younger guys, probably about 40 years and on under. And we had asked them the question, "How many of y'all are from the generation of the millennials?" And about every hand went up, about every single hand went up, and I'm part of that generation too. And we were explaining to them, you know, somewhere that generation has fell back. Somewhere that generation missed God. And the way to pick that generation out is they're known to be very spontaneous. Very quick, I see something I like right away, I'll get it. Only to later on find out, you know what, I shouldn't have done that. That was a bad move that I made. Another thing you'll find in that generation is irresponsibleness. They're not responsible. Finger pointing. It wasn't my fault, it's your fault. And you know, these men, they click with that thing. And the thing we brought up to them was, you know, what are we portraying to the generation that's coming on behind us? There's a generation behind us that's following. And they right away got it. And anyway, some of those men, they were able to repent. They got the message of it. But you know, repentance can change that. Just because you're a part of that generation, just because you're a part of those things, there is still repentance. We still serve a God who can save us to the uttermost. A God that can bring us through victoriously. I have a scripture here somewhere I was trying to find. I'm going to go to Lamentations. Actually, no, it's not the right one. Psalms. think it's Psalm 63, if I can find it there. I'm going to read this passage of Scripture, Psalm 63. O Lord, Thou art my God, early will I seek Thee. My soul thirsteth for Thee, my flesh longeth for Thee, in a dry and thirsty land where no water is. To see Thy power and Thy glory, so as I have seen Thee in the sanctuary. Because Thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise Thee. Thus will I bless Thee while I live. I will lift up my hands to Thy name. My soul shall be satisfied with the marrow and fatness of thy mouth, shall praise thee with joyful lips. When I remember thee upon my bed and meditate on thee in the night watches, because thou hast been my help, therefore in the shadow of thy wings will I rejoice. May, verse 8, my soul followeth hard after thee, thy right hand upholdeth me. But those that seek my soul to destroy it shall go into the lower parts of the earth. They shall fall by the sword, they shall be the portion of the foxes. But the king shall rejoice in the Lord. Everyone that sweareth by him shall glory, but the mouth of them that speak lies shall be stopped. You know, back to the thing of the mind, I want to encourage you tonight to take action on how we think, or, you know, how comfortable are you around this thing that's, God doesn't really recommend it in your life. It's not holy, it won't bring holiness, it won't bring righteousness to your life. And it's a good idea to get that thing cut off of our lives. You know, something that I've learned going to prisons is in order to get into some of these men's hearts, sometimes you just need to go up to them and show them some peace, show them some care, some goodness, some mercy. And it's amazing the way that they open up when the right kind of response is there. You know, there's many out there that I believe if you and I don't go after them, their lives are going to be damned. And so I want to encourage you with that. Let's be a people that are going to be enthused about taking care of this mind. Let's be enthused about serving the Lord. I know there's trials, there's tests, there's tribulations, there's wilderness, deserts, things that you might go through from time to time. But you know, something I've found out is when you go through these situations, when you handle them correctly, there's always some kind of joy, some kind of anointing that is on the other side of that valley or whatever you went through that is far better than the fight that it took for you to get through it. You know, my wife, a number of years ago, she was somewhat on her, she was battling between life and death. This is about, might have been about 8 years ago or so, I'm not sure. And it was a rough time for me in my life, very rough, difficult. I remember nights I would pray pretty much all night. There was one night, I might have slept about a half hour. Every time I would fall asleep, she would wake me back up and say, I need you to pray for me. And she had a sickness in her life. And that night I went over to my little boy and my little girl's room. They were just really small at that time. Not sure if they both remember it or not. But I told them, I said, you know, I need you to come over here. We're going to lay our hands on Mama. And I led them through a prayer. And that prayer was along the lines of, Father, spare our mother. We need her to raise us up in the coming days. We need her here for our future. And it was a difficult time, but I look back at that time. There's so many things I learned going through that situation. I can't necessarily say that I want to do it over again, but I'll tell you what, some of these tough predicaments, they teach you how to grow. They teach you how to trust on this Word. One Bible verse I stood on time and time again was, Father, your Word says that you are a very present help in a time of need. And I'm in a time where I have a need in my life, and I need you to come through. I remember the one night that spirit of death showed up. And it was a battle fighting that thing. But you know, I kept fighting that thing, and it was because of the churches. I was back and forth with Apostle Rhodes and these men of God down here. And there was something, whenever I got on the phone with them, there was something again put inside of me. No, I won't stop. I'm going to keep fighting. It's a possibility. It's a good possibility. We can be completely victorious over this situation. And I remember before everything snapped, I had this vision of, it was a huge army was going up to the top of a mountain. And when they got up to the top of the mountain, they all stopped and they looked back. And then I realized, you know, that's what I was fighting against. And I remember them up on top of that mountain, and I made a decision. If they turn around and they come back down here again, I will fight with everything I have again. I'll do it one more time. And we just stood there and looked at each other for a while. And after a bit, one by one, down over the hill, they vanished. And it was from that time on I felt a victory. I felt, you know, joy. There's something about joy can come in the morning. So I want to encourage you with that. Sometimes a good fight is the best thing you and I can have.
That's right.
It'll teach us how to grow up. You won't hate your brother. You won't hate your sister. I usually see it as when we go through the good times, when everything is good, is when these little petty things start cropping up the most. Mm-hmm. And God cares about us. And He wants each one of us here to be victorious, and we can be victorious. I'm not saying y'all ain't as a church. I appreciate y'all as a church. But I want to stir that thing up inside of us. Folks, let's continue to walk this path. I like what Brother Rhodes usually says. He says, my quitter, I lost it. I don't know where it's at. I believe that's a good thing for each one of us to get. That quitter, we don't know where that thing's at. It doesn't work. Because I tell you, there's going to be a reward for those that endure this thing into the end. There will be a reward there for you. You know, I was talking with a brother today, and he was telling me about when this thing's all said and done, there's going to be tremendous weeping. There's going to be tremendous crying. And it's not going to be. It's going to be coming from a people who recognize, you know, I miss God. If only I'd have known the rewards were this great of enduring, of going through the wilderness, going through the times of testing, going through the times of trial. There's a reward there for us, something for you and I to be excited about. Anyway, I want to bless you all with that. Appreciate you coming out tonight. Thank you again for your hospitality here. This church has been a great blessing to us in Pennsylvania. You know, up in Pennsylvania, I don't know if we had a church up there. If you all wanted to come up, and probably we wouldn't. Brother Rhodes knows. If it wouldn't have been for them stepping in and helping us out back in the times when we needed some help. And they showed us some care. They showed us some long-suffering. They brought up teaching time and time again that would cause us to become stable. We had this thing where we used to get unstable really quick. Stability, godliness with contentment, it's great gain. And something I see today more than ever, you know, if you see some kind of rapid growth somewhere going on in Christianity, I'm going to recommend you to not jump in on that thing. Stay away from it. You know, a true believer, he's going to grow one step at a time. One step at a time. Then another step. Just like that cornfield, it's a slow, steady growth all the way through the summer.
That's right, brother.
And I believe that's what God's looking for in us. Anyway, Pastor Kevin, I'm going to turn the time over to you. Thank you all for the invitation down here.